NASA reached to the west for the European-built Columbus Laboratory, and now it turns to the east for a Japanese-made science module named Kibo that means hope. The first Kibo segment, a pressurized logistics module, along with a Canadian robotic system named Dexter, will ride into orbit aboard Space Shuttle Endeavour, bringing new potential for space research. Endeavour and its seven-member crew are ready for an international mission, one that represents the collective space ambition of three nations. The countdown for the launch of Space Shuttle Endeavour is underway. Live from Kennedy Space Center, this is continuing coverage of the countdown to launch of Space Shuttle Endeavour on mission STS-123.
Thanks for joining us. I'm your host, Allard Beutel, News Chief here at NASA's Kennedy Space Center. We're less than 15 hours away from the launch of Space Shuttle Endeavour on the STS-123 mission. Just a few hours ago, technicians moved away a protective housing called the rotating service structure from Endeavour as launch preparations move closer to liftoff on Tuesday, March 11th at 2:28 a.m. Eastern. This mission is truly an international effort. The International Space Station is about to go global with elements from Russia, Europe, Canada, the United States, and now Japan. Coming up, we'll take a closer look at this 25th shuttle mission to the station. And to help us do that, NASA and Canadian Space Agency astronaut Julie Payette will be here in a moment to discuss what work awaits the Endeavour's crew members. But before we begin, let's take a quick look at those seven astronauts.
A veteran of three space flights, Commander Dom Gorey leads the team on the 16-day mission. STS-123 will be the first space flight for pilot Gregory Johnson and mission specialists Bob Banken, Mike Foreman, and Garrett Reisman. Also a veteran of three space flights, mission specialist Rick Lenahan has logged more than 43 days in space. And Takao Doi carries the hope for Japan, as he will be the first to enter the Japanese Kibo logistics segment.
Now that we've met the STS-123 crew, let's meet veteran NASA astronaut Julie Payette, who is scheduled to actually fly on the STS-127 mission next year.
That is correct.
And thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
So let's get... What are you guys doing? What is the crew doing right now?
They're probably about to get up because they've shifted their days. We're launching at 2 a.m. in the morning, so they will wake up late in the morning, have a breakfast, and then start preparing. There's a whole suit-up process that goes on that takes quite a while. They have to put on their suit in this very, very historical room where we suit up in the crew quarters. That's the same room where the Apollo astronauts going to the moon put their white spacesuit. So it's kind of special for all the astronauts. But that takes a little while. They have to make sure the suits won't leak. And then they will walk out to the pad hours before the launch, get strapped in, then await the countdown.
And like you said, you're right, this mission is primarily, for us here in the Eastern time zone, it's primarily a night mission. And all the spacewalks and everything will take place, so they just, as we call it, sleep shift, and take their time to sleep during the day and get up and work at night. Now, you went to the station in 1999, so obviously besides it being bigger, how's the station changed since then?
Oh, it's changed enormously, and I feel very privileged that I will have seen it from the very beginning of the program to almost the completion of the construction. When I was there in 1999, there was only two modules, and they had been put together just a month before we had arrived. It was a Russian module, Zarya, and the Node 1 Unity. Inside, there was nobody. Actually, there was almost nothing. We were bringing most of the initial equipment to outfit the interior and a little bit of the exterior. So when we opened the hatch, the ground had switched off the light from the ground and basically turned on the heat, but there was nobody on board. Today, we have people permanently inside the station. We have permanent crew that rotate every 6 months. So it's going to be very different when we knock at the hatch this time. We're going to have somebody else on the other side. And of course, it's immense compared to what I saw in 1999.
Well, yeah, the three-bedroom sized apartment, and you're right, it's we've had people almost for about 8 years now, going up on 8 years of permanent crewing of the station, which is exactly what we're supposed to be doing up there. The STS-123 crew will deliver the first section of Japan's laboratory, the Kibo. What does a small module add to the overall station?
This is a milestone. You can appreciate that Japan has been waiting for this moment for a long, long time and has been preparing all of its equipment for launch. Because the Kibo module, the main module, is so large, it takes the entire cargo bay of the space shuttle. It's impossible to send it with every other elements that comes with it. So what we decided is to send the pressurized module that has stowage place, some experimental equipment in there ahead of time, because it's small enough that we can park it on one of the nodes of the space station until the next flight, when the big Kibo module will be hooked up to the station. And once that is accomplished, then the crew will pick up the small pressurized module and put it on top of Kibo, where it's going to stay. It's its final location for the rest of the life of station.
And that actually goes exactly what you said. We have to do three shuttle missions because this laboratory, the Japanese laboratory, is so big. This is the first one, and, well, coincidentally, your mission, STS-127, next year will be the final mission, and we take up the last pieces.
Indeed.
How are all these pieces going to work together?
Well, the pressurized module, of course, is a laboratory. Just like Destiny, the U.S. lab is a laboratory. Columbus, that we just installed for the European Space Agency, is a laboratory. And we have the Russian laboratories as well. This is where we conduct the experiments inside. The little pressurized module that we're bringing up on 123 is for stowage. It's actually quite small. It's the size of a closet when you go inside. You can't float about. Kibo is very large and will have incredible capacity for microgravity science inside. But what the Japanese have also developed is an exposed facility. We, the astronaut, we kind of dub it the porch, because you install it at the very tip of the big module, and in there will be experiments which will be exposed to the vacuum of space. They won't be inside a pressurized module, inside normal air and normal pressure. They will be out there exposed to the elements of space. And that is what we're bringing on the third flight, the flight that I'll be on.
And that helps. Why do we want to do that? Why do you want to have?
Well, particularly we want to study materials. We know materials degrade in space. Space is a very hostile environment. It has radiation, micrometeorites, extremes of temperature that changes all the time. It's not, no pressure, no air, no nothing. So materials degrade in space, and when we build satellites, we want the satellites to be as robust as possible, because it costs a lot of money to send a satellite out there, and we certainly depend on these. Same for spacecraft and spacecraft that house people, particularly we want them to be safe. So we'll be testing some materials. We'll be testing also some fluids and trying to do new mixture of metals and materials to see if we can't come up with things more robust. And we need then afterwards to just expose them to the vacuum of space and see how they behave.
Okay, that takes place next year. But besides obviously the Japanese module that we're taking up, a new Canadian robotic system called Dexter is flying on Endeavour. And it's as close as you can get to an extra spacewalker.
Dextre is another Canadian contribution to the International Space Station. It supplements a robotic arm already in place called Canada Arm 2. Dextre is like an extra pair of hands that will extend the arm's reach to help future construction of the space station. With its big arm, Canada Arm 2 can move around the station's exterior, move large modules, and help spacewalkers perform their tasks. But Dextre can carry out operations too delicate for the big arm. It has a unique ability to tackle assignments with more precision. Think of Dextre as helping hands that use a set of arms equipped with claws to handle very precise movements. It can't replace a spacewalker completely, but it will make many tasks simpler because it handles duties previously only spacewalkers could perform.